So the problem to address it is that the scholarly publication process is quite sort of slow in London. You do some research, you do a certain amount of research, you publish it, you send it off for peer review, you get it back later, make sure the paper comes out. But in practice, science technology is more of a continuous process, it's incremental. And there's always more questions than there's time to answer. So you know, often receive things for data, you've got more time to do. If maybe other people could sort of extend that, that's a good thing. It's also about how reproducible research ideas might be able to help with this. So I'm going to start by giving you sort of a background to reproducible research, and it's about how we can sort of fit Docker into this, and the benefits and challenges of following this approach. So it also starts off in the mid-80s, really, with Knuth and his work on literary programming. And this is the idea of mixing text and code together. But this is very much a way of doing programming, it's a way of writing algorithms. So I think it's useful to think about this in terms of diagrams up here. Effectively, we're using this literary programming as a programming tool, essentially. More recently, we've got things like PyPython, Notebook Shoots, and Notebooks. And again, you can use these for programming. You can also use it to make the interactive notebooks, which you've probably all seen. What comes out of these typically doesn't look like a scholarly paper. You've got text, you've got code. It's a useful thing, but it's a different thing to a scholarly paper. If you look at using Knitter and R, this can do something which looks very much like an IPython notebook. You can also use it to make something that looks exactly like a normal scholarly paper but has a benefit of reproducibility. And so the way it does this is it lets us leave chunks of markdown and low tech with R code, and the R sessions persist throughout the document, so you're sort of effectively running your code and your text in parallel. And as I said, you can produce it looks exactly like a normal paper at the end of this. So when you actually reproduce it, you can't actually reproduce it without a paper source. Let me give you a quick example. This is an actual reproducible paper. So I've got some. So we've got some LaTeX up here, which is in the bog standard article class, a bit more LaTeX here. Here's some R code, which is looking at an example data set, doing a progression. Got a sort of figure here, which is this one code here. And then just pulling out the slope coefficient from that. And this will work, you can run this through NISA, and you get a paper exactly like this. And this is actually what it produces. So I've done these slides using continuous integration, but I've built a slide to actually run this paper from the text in this file here, and splits out PDF and does it for PNG. So this is entirely reproducible. And you can see we've got the figure here, and we've got the number we've called in there. So that's what we're doing. Obviously, the real paper is a bit more complicated. And doing something is a good thing, and we've talked about the reasons why this is a good thing in previous talks. It makes students properly, it's completely transparent, other people check your work, it's going to repeat your work. But it doesn't necessarily make it easy to extend or reuse the work, it's still very much just a static, albeit a very transparent thing. And this is where Docker comes in. And what we've been doing is breaking our analysis pipeline into sections. And this most recent modular workflow, it makes it much easier to improve or extend the work. So effectively we're using a make file as the glue to handle dependencies between all the modules. And the other important thing this is that the manuscript is just another module. So it fits into the analysis pipeline. It's not the paper isn't anything special, it's just another output from the whole system. So I'll give you an example where we're using this ID interaction experiment I'm working on. And basically the aim of this is we've got a video, and the idea is that the user's got a tablet on the table, and then looking at a TV screen, they're going to spot the difference experiments. They've got to sort of mark the differences between the picture on the screen, the picture of the tablet, and sort of click on them. And we're just finding how it takes them to do that, and sort of how we're doing that. And one of the things we want to know is when they look at the TV screen, when they look at the tablet. And you can do this by hand, just going through frame by frame, noting when they're doing this. And that's really slow and really tedious and not much fun. And so the idea is we're trying to automate the coding of these behaviours. And so we've tried lots of ways of doing this. So effectively what we've got video data up here, depth data up here, and then we're using two different techniques to track the face. This one's called object tracking. Basically, you draw a box around the face on the first frame of the experiment, and then the algorithms will sort of follow the box. This next one is using face detection, so it's actually saying this is a face, I'm following the face, but the algorithm knows it's a face. And we've got two different techniques of handling the depth face, so the principal component house is here, this is going to shoot onto it here. Basically, the algorithm is then going to a decision tree classifier, and that's sort of the main analysis part, and then out pops a paper at the end. So each of these boxes here are basically a Docker image. So if you just notice on the top left one, which is the object tracking one, so this is calling some OpenCVPMT, which is in C++, which is OpenCV, and that's a Docker image. It's got a makefile, so it ingests the MP4s, outputs the CSV file containing the tracking data, and get user input for basically where the vision to start tracking, and the sort of you then basically enter the box around the face on that frame. And we've got a different Docker image to do the face tracking. This again uses OpenCV, it actually uses a different version of OpenCV from the object tracking. That would be really difficult to do without using Docker, so we've got different, same language, different version. But then the other parts all use Python, scikit-learn. And then the final part of the pipeline uses an environment R, LaTeX, and this with it. And that's also got the class of the journal we're planning to submit to as well. So what comes out actually looks like a paper. And then to tie this together, we've got a top-level make file, which handles the dependencies between image modules and then calls the final image to produce a manuscript. And so this makes the pipeline more efficient because we're not having to recompute things. If we just change the manuscript, we don't have to run all the tracking again, which is quite slow. So by doing this, this modularized makes it easier to extend papers. So say we had different tracking technique we wanted to use, we could just write a Docker image for it, plug it in, and then add that to the paper. So we don't. It avoids the temptation to slow and slice papers, you could extend the paper and sort of make a second version of it if you wanted. The containerization lets us make the paper anywhere. And because we're doing this reproducible way, it's completely transparent. The publisher, reviewers, readers can check the code. And because it's all in version control, it's very obvious what's changed if we extend the paper, so you could just peer review this, which has changed. And just to emphasize here, we're not treating the paper, we're treating that final Docker image, it's just another part of the software. So it's in version control. We could use continuous integration, but we're not at the moment. We can do unit testing and so on too. It's just like another piece of software. It's a sort of practical sort of step. So I found it useful to keep intermediate analysis steps when we're doing this. Some of the steps are quite slow to run, so we don't have to lose work. Making the NISA paper run along the native system is sort of outside the Docker container is useful, so you can sort of incrementally write the paper and use facilities in RStudio to see your figures in line while you're working and so on. And also it's worth sort of putting testing assertions you make in the text with our code. So if you say something to double check it has, and then if your data changes, then that's no longer true, you get an error in the PDF that comes out, and you know it's not self-consistent. So there are some challenges to this. It is extra overhead writing make files to sort of do everything together. The overhead is minimized, I think, if you should start working this way from the outset. So one of the images I'm using in this was written before I started on the project. So I just plug that straight into the pipeline, and that's that same time. The manuscript contains quite generic, that could be shared, we could use other papers as it is. The really key is good glue to sort of streamline the work, put everything together. We're using a makefile in a minute. People talk about other approaches today, which I think will work quite well as well. The fact is, this is an American provided document. It makes it harder to work offline collaboratively. So, say people are editing the paper on, say, Overleaf or it's a Google Doc, that's harder to do because it's sort of so intertwined with the analysis itself. So the way we've handled that is we've written a script which will basically just comment out all the R code and then effectively end up with a plain LaTeX file which you can use offline. You don't get the figures, but you can edit the text, check the other mistakes in the LaTeX. When you've done the work offline, you've finished work on the train, you can then just run the script again, put it up, uncomment the R code, and then you're back to where you were. As I said, all of this is minimized if you sort of start thinking about doing this from the outset. The benefits are each module is independent, so we can use the images to actually do sort of work, you know, on other projects, on other data sets if we want without having to write a paper. So it's reusable and it's reproducible. So we've got no image trace that can figure back to its original source. If a reader's really interested, they can sort of see all the data, see all the code, really understand what we're doing. I think it's sort of essential to reshape the publication process. As this final couple of slides is a bit more sort of speculative thinking about whether a sort of academic paper should be a standard form of research output. I mean, is it better than a Jupyter notebook? And if it is, why? And partly it comes down to who's reading it. I think there's issues around the fact that academic outputs are the sort of currency of academia in terms of research evaluation assessment. So I think it's likely that papers will be continuing the primary means of dissemination for the time being. But I think this gets us towards something which is a bit more sort of interactive and you can actually really dig under the bonnet if you want. So just to conclude, NISA itself makes writing a paper of an R easier. I think a lot of the complexity comes as soon as we leave the R ecosystem. So the fact we're having to use this C code and this Python code to pull that in, that makes it more complicated. But Docker's reduced that complexity by modularizing it. As I said, the extra work is minimized if the process is embedded from the outset. So I'm just going to leave you some bibliography and use for them some further reading. That's me.